Bubbling, come on, man.
Bubbling over.
Yeah. Now, before we started again, Lorraine was so sweetly singing that the women over here really didn't get to know what they were supposed to sing, Lorraine.
He thinks I'm singing it wrong.
Well, no, I don't think they heard you because the men were so overpowering.
Okay. So the ladies will have to help me.
Here's what you have to sing on this side. Okay, Lorraine, you show them how it goes.
Jesus' love is a bubbling over. Jesus' love is a bubbling in my soul. Jesus' love is a bubbling over. Jesus' love is in my soul.
All right, got that, ladies? Yeah. He wasn't singing. Okay, come on, Blair.
But that's real. That's
really okay.
High.
Here we go. Ba 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 len. 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 Ba 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 len.
Ba ba
ba ba ba len. Ba 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 len.
Ba 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 ba
len.
Ba 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 ba
ba len.
Ba 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 All right. Now, we've got another song. Mary Ellen, you better go over there because you're going to have to teach them how to do the important actions. Yeah.
Okay, so I need to help with this one.
Everybody knows Jesus loves me, right? Yeah. Y'all know Jesus loves me, so we're just going to do a little faster version of it, okay? All right. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong. Na 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 na. Hey! Na 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 na. Na 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 na. Na 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 na. Now, here's the second verse. Jesus loves me, he who died, heaven's gates to open wide. He will wash away my sin, let his little child come in. Na 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 na. All right, you can sit down for a moment. Okay, Sarah's got something that she's going to share. Looks like the beginnings of a pumpkin pie. I don't know why I would think that.
All right. Good morning, children. And good morning, everyone else. Something's going to happen this week that probably you might be a little excited for. Does anybody know what that is? Halloween, yeah. And although it's not really a Christian holiday, a lot of you will take part in it. And several years ago now, Paula came upstairs and she did a lesson with us that I remember, and I wanted to do it in a very quick form with you this morning. We're obviously not going to, as groups, do pumpkins, but we want to talk about a little bit how Christians can be like jack-o'-lanterns. Do you think we have much in common with a jack-o'-lantern? If you look at the pumpkin over here? No? No? Maybe some of us can get our mouths quite that wide, I don't know, but I'm definitely not orange. Well, I don't think, unless I'm eating a lot of carrots. But I'm going to share with you a little bit how we can be like jack-o'-lanterns today, okay? So being a Christian is like being a jack-o'-lantern. What do you have to do first when you're going to make a jack-o'-lantern? Cut it open? Well, we have to do that at some point in time. But what if we don't have a pumpkin? We have to go get one, right? And then usually when you go, there's a field of pumpkins or a bunch of pumpkins in maybe on a shelf. What do you have to do? You have to pick one, right? You have to pick one. You have to say, sometimes they can be a little lopsided. Sometimes they might be small or large or medium sized. You have to kind of choose which one you want, okay? So the first thing is that we have to choose one, right? And do you know what? God chooses us too, right? He knows us and he chooses us. So God picks us from the patch, okay? And he brings us in. In John 15, 16, he says, "You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you may go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you." Okay, so he chooses us, just like we choose our pumpkin, which one we think is going to make the best jack-o'-lantern. And if you get yours from a farm, is there going to be maybe stuff all over it first? If you get it out of the ground, might be some dirt on it, yeah? Are you going to start making your jack-o'-lantern then, or are you going to wash your pumpkin? Yeah, you're going to wash your pumpkin. In order to be able to make it look the way you want, you're going to wash it all off. And what does God do for us when we choose to live for him? What does he do, Archie? Yeah, he washes away our sins. Good job. Thanks. In 2 Corinthians 5:17, it says, "Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things pass away. Behold, all things become new." So he washes us clean. Okay, and then when we get it home and we get ready, what are we going to do? We're going to cut it open, like Elsie said earlier, and then what are we going to do? We're going to scoop out all of the, ooh, yes, all those pumpkin seeds, right? And all the, do you like putting your hand in the pumpkin, feeling that gooey stuff? Oh, you do? Oh, not me. Not me at all. I want to use a spoon and touch the least amount as possible. Okay, so he opens us up and he scoops out all the yucky stuff. That's what Archie was talking about, all that sin. And he removes, the more we get to know him, the more we kind of dig in, he removes the things of seeds of doubt and fear and hate and greed. Okay, and that we get from Romans 6:6. "For we know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body ruled by sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin." All right, so now after we've got everything out of the pumpkin, what's our next step? It still looks like a pumpkin, right? So what are we going to do next? Close, next step. You remember that. What did you say? We're going to carve it, yes. And this actually was not carved by me. I have to say that this was gifted to us by a young man who came to the giveaway yesterday. He had been somewhere and had done this with his friends, and after he shopped our giveaway and had lunch, he decided that he would gift our church with a pumpkin and left it outside in our garden for us. So that's what I'm using this morning. So I am not this talented. So we carve our pumpkins, and we usually put a kind of face in them. So our pumpkins may look a little scary, but for us, okay, God carves a new smiling face for us, and that comes from Psalm 71:23. "My lips will shout for joy when I sing praise to you, I whom you have delivered." So we sing praise to the Lord, and we smile for all of the wonderful things that he has given to us. And then lastly, Archie talked about this, and I actually forgot to bring a candle with me. But Archie, what did you say is the last thing that we do? We light it up, yes. All right, and so God puts a light in us so that we can shine to others and share him with others. And that's just what we do with jack-o'-lanterns. We put a light in so people can see their way. And Matthew 5:16 is where that comes from today. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. So that's how we can be like a jack-o'-lantern, and we can shine for Jesus. All right, so that concludes me this morning. So when we come down, we're gonna start to head up to upstairs for our lesson.
David. Yeah.
No, you go ahead.
Just before we get back into worship, I just want to pray for Willard's sister-in-law who passed away, Norma's sister. And we just found out that Louise Swift's sister has passed. And there's so much to pray for. I was with Pastor Johnny down in Halifax because a member of his church, their 12-year-old son Caleb, had a brain tumor that was discovered at an eye exam only last week, the size of a baseball. We don't know if they were able to get the whole tumor out, but they're biopsying it, and hopefully within the next couple of weeks, we just trust that there'll be a good prognosis. So there's a lot of heartache, a lot of hardship going on around us. So let's bow our heads and stand with these and others who are going through a really tough time, Father. Father God, loss, you know loss, and you know how hard it is for us. Pray for Willard and his family, his sister-in-law, Norma's sister. Pray for Louise Swift with everything she's going through with chemo and her diagnosis and now to lose a sister. That's hard, Father. And the Jay family with, I can't imagine their son, you know, a prognosis like this and brain surgery. These are big, deep things, Father. So I pray that your presence would be with all of these people who are really going through the darkness. That valley of shadow of death, Father. The psalm tells us that your rod and staff and you are with them, guiding them, leading them. Give them a very real sense that you are with them. Louise, be with her. Help her to feel you even right now. Norma and Willard and the family there, Father, just help them to just feel your presence in a very real way. The Jay family with their son Caleb. Bring comfort, bring peace in your presence, Father, even though we're going through challenging, confusing, questioning situations, those seeds of doubt that Sarah just mentioned, they're in all of us. And sometimes when we go through these dark things, those seeds, their voices seem a little louder than usual. Wipe them away, Father, in your presence. Is light and peace and comfort. And help these people to know that they have a church family to turn to that will stand with them in what they're going through. We love you. We thank you for family. We thank you that we have a place to come and just be with what we're feeling, good, bad, and confusing. We lift it all to you. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand as we continue in worship.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I'll worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my
thousand reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship your holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul. Worship your holy name. Draws near and my time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, O my soul. O my soul, worship His holy. Darkness shining, Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us, set us free by the truth you now bring us, shine on me, shine on me, shine, Jesus, shine, fill this land. Father's glory, blaze, Spirit, blaze, set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, flow, flood the nations with grace and mercy. Send forth your word, Lord, and let awesome presence from the shadows into your radiance. By the blood I may enter your brightness. Search me, try me, consume all my darkness. Shine on me. Shine on me. Shine, Jesus, shine, fill this land with the Father's glory. Blaze, Spirit, blaze, set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, flow, flood the nations with grace and mercy. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. As we gaze on your kingly brightness, so our faces display your likeness, ever changing from glory to glory. Mirrored here, may our lives tell your story. Shine on me. Shine on me. Shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. Blaze, Spirit, blaze.
nations with grace and mercy. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light.
You folks are singing wonderfully, and we have so much to be gracious and thankful for. I'd like us to conclude our time of singing together with this song. Lord, I come,
I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I need you. Where sin runs deep, your grace is born. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I need you. Teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. When I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
Lord, I need you.
Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my right. Oh God, how I need you.
Lord, I need you.
Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God.
Y'all can be seated. Jean Petrino has an announcement she'd like to make. Thank you, team. Okay. Gotcha.
Good morning. What a super day. We are planning a Christmas house tour. I'm excited about it. It will be December the 7th, which is a Saturday. Four houses, hopefully, 2 in Stratford. The bridge will be finished by then. Don't worry about that. One house.
Promise?
Okay. One house will serve hot apple cider and cookies. Another house will have a Santa teddy bear in a sleigh on the front door and lots of nutcrackers inside. We're doing a lot of advertising. One will be in the buzz hopefully tomorrow, and we'll do that again at the end of November. We'll go in the Guardian once about 2 days before the event, and I'll be on Compass on December 4th. So we're covering all of the ads. Now, what I would like you to do is to fill your car with people who are not members of Central. We need to have more people than our congregation here. We're trying to make money still to fix the roof and the steeple. I think it will be great. Lots of children. My house will have, I don't know how many Christmas trees in it.
Lord have mercy.
Right. Mary Ellen will be helping too.
Yeah. Oh, thank you, Lord.
So we are looking for a fourth house. We only have 3 and we'd like 4. So if you know of someone, and they don't have to be a member of Central, just someone who loves decorating and is willing to have people go through the house. Hopefully everybody will take their shoes off, or we'll have someone at the door requesting that just in case the weather's bad. Don't worry about that. So again, it will be December the 7th, a Saturday. Tickets will go on sale here November 7th at $20. So please buy the tickets. We'd love to see you. And happy Halloween.
It's beginning to look a lot. Scripture.
Good morning, everyone. I've got a really good scripture to read this morning. It's a pretty comforting story. So, it's from Luke chapter 7, verses 36 to 50, if anyone wants to follow along. When one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to have dinner with him, he went to the Pharisee's house and reclined at the table. A woman in that town who lived a sinful life learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house, so she came there with an alabaster jar of perfume. As she stood behind him at his feet weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears. Then she wiped them with her hair, kissed them, and poured perfume on them. When the Pharisee who invited him saw this, he said to himself, "If this man were a prophet, he would know who was touching him and what kind of woman she is." Sinner. Jesus answered him, "Simon, I have something to tell you." "Tell me, teacher," he said. "Two people owed money to a certain moneylender. One owed him 500 denarii and the other 50. Neither of them had the money to pay him back, so he forgave the debts of both. Now which of them will love him more?" Simon replied, "I suppose the one who had the bigger debt forgiven." "You have judged correctly," Jesus said. Then he turned toward the woman and said to Simon, "Do you see this woman? I came into your house. You did not give me any water for my feet, but she wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You did not give me a kiss, but this woman from the time I entered has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not put oil on my head, but she has poured perfume on my feet. Therefore I tell you, her many sins have been forgiven, as her great love has shown, but whoever has been forgiven little loves little." Then Jesus said to her, "Your sins are forgiven." The other guests began to say amongst themselves, "Who is this who even forgives sins?" Jesus said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." Amen to that.
Let's bow our heads in prayer. That is indeed an amazing reading, Lord, and we just thank you for your word that is so full of readings like that, that have such an impact on our spirit and our souls and our minds and emotions, Lord, just to imagine this woman and how blown away she is, because obviously she recognizes that Jesus is God, Jesus is your son, and that Jesus loves her even when she was full of sin and darkness and bad things, that you were there to rescue her and to take her out of that dark place and bring her into a place of beauty and a place where she felt she could come in and show Jesus the love that she has for him with a beautiful, amazing scent of perfume. And Lord, we just pray that you would help us to come to you with a beautiful scent of repentance, Lord, and forgiveness of those who have sinned against us, and an amazing gratitude, Lord, for your forgiveness in our lives and what it means to us, Lord, that we can come before your throne of grace and receive mercy and find the grace that we need to help us in our time of need. And also, Lord, to know that we are not going forward on our own, that your Holy Spirit is with us and in us to direct us and guide us to lead the life that you have called us to, and to learn how to love others as you love us. And Lord, we thank you so much for this scripture, and we pray you'd be with Pastor Tripp as he brings the message, Lord, about these amazing verses, Lord, that we will all be drawn to you in faith, Lord, and a life of commitment and love for you and for those around us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, team. What a powerful story, huh? So as we're continuing to build a foundation of biblical worship in our lives and as a church, we learned at the beginning of this series how to worship the King, that the word worship comes from the Old English Weirth Sippy, which means to attribute worth to something. And when you attribute worth to something, it becomes valuable to us, it is valuable to us, and therefore we invest in it. An investment is sacrifice, thus worship is sacrifice. It always involves giving, whether it's time, talent, or treasure. Whole life, holy for a holy God. God wants all of what we offer him in worship, all of us. And Paul says in Romans 12:1, therefore I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. No matter what we're feeling, no matter what we're going through, God wants all of us. That's true worship, and that's the worship that he desires of us. We also learned that worship is a verb where God is both the subject and the object. He initiates the encounter with his mercy and grace and forgiveness in Jesus, and it's to him we greatly, gratefully respond. So this revelation and response is constant, and our worshiping of him never ceases. We read in Revelation 4:8, day after day, night after night, they keep on saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God, the Almighty, the one who always was, who is, and who is still to come. So on earth as it is in heaven, our worship should never cease. And finally, we learned that worship is commanded of us. And in the original languages, this is the highest form, the strongest form of a command that one can give. God is faithful to us, and we are commanded to respond in thanksgiving and praise as his children. So in the hopes of deepening our understanding, I'd like to bring in some of the richness of the Old Testament Hebrew and the New Testament Greek languages. Because as we're learning, there's not just one word for worship in those languages. Each word adds another layer of this amazing gift of praise, this response of gratitude that we can offer God and that He's pleased to receive. The Greek and the Hebrew languages, you'll begin to see why God chose these languages for our scriptures. They offer amazing similarities in these words that they use to describe worship. And I just want to look at a couple. We'll look at a couple this week. We'll look at a couple next week as well. So scripture tells us that our attitude as we approach God in worship should be one of humility. The first words in both the Hebrew on the left and the Hebrew on the right literally mean to incline one's face to the ground, to prostrate oneself. Proskuneo in the Greek and shata in the Hebrew. The Hebrew word conveys an image of exposing your armpits, meaning as you're bowing low, your hands are outstretched and thus your underarms are exposed. These words are very complex. They describe not only a body position, but in order to get down that low, to choose to get down that low, it's an attitude and activity of humility, of reverence and honor. You know, in writings outside of our Bibles, these words are used in the context of royalty and monarchs. Specifically, the words refer to how high your head is in relation to the king or the monarch. It should always be lower. So this is a reflexive reaction to the presence of the king. If you go even further back in history, the roots of these words come from the pagan ritual, and we see it in some films, and sometimes maybe we even do it after a bumpy ride on a boat or a plane. It's the ritual of lying down on the ground, kissing the earth after a particularly arduous journey. I've done that before. I've been on some bumpy landings with planes. You get off and you're just, oh, thank you, God, I'm on the earth safely. That's getting to the mindset of it. And we read, for example, Odysseus and Agamemnon. They prostrate themselves and kiss the earth after a happy journey, one scholar writes. So this is the origin, not only in the Greek word, but the action and attitude of bowing down in submission and thanksgiving. This idea is carried over into the biblical languages, the Psalms. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. In his first letter to the Corinthians, the Apostle Paul writes, he will fall down with his face to the ground in worshiping God, declaring God is really among you. So a prime example of this humble worship is seen in our reading today. Luke 7, Jesus, we just heard, has been invited to dine with a Pharisee. And while there, we're told, a woman who lives a sinful life came to Jesus in tears, just interrupted the meal. She had an expensive jar of perfume with her, and she fell at his feet. And we read that her tears actually wet his feet. And if you remember in that culture, when you visited someone's house, you'd take your sandals off, they'd offer you a bowl of water to wash your feet as you enter the house. You know, as Jean was talking with these Christmas events, we're going into other people's house, it was a sign of respect to take off your shoes, wash your feet, so that you leave the house as you found it. Not only did she then wipe his tear-stained feet with her hair, could you imagine? What did she think of herself in that moment? I mean, getting into that mindset is fascinating, isn't it? Wiping his feet with her hair and her tears. And these alabaster jars of perfume were very, very expensive. Very expensive. And she cracked it open and spilled it, anointed his feet. And the Pharisee, at this amazing scene, was disgusted with this woman's display. I wonder what was in his heart and mind to look at this beautiful scene of adoration, right? And this sacrifice of praise, but then to be disgusted, you know? Said to himself, man, if this guy was a prophet and knew who was touching his feet, man, would he even let her do this? She's a sinner. We're all sinners, right? Jesus, knowing his thoughts, do you see this woman? I came into your house, Simon. You didn't give me water for my feet, but she's wetting my feet with her tears. And now she's wiping them with her hair. You didn't give me a kiss. In that culture, you greeted each other with a kiss. But this woman, since the time I've entered, has not been kissing my face, not been kissing my hands. She's been kissing my feet. Dirty feet, right, that you didn't give me a bowl to clean off. Nevertheless, she's kissing my feet. You didn't put oil on my head. That was a show of respect. Welcome to my home. You are a blessed guest. Let me anoint you with oil. We pray that God would bless our home and that you would be blessed as our guest. That's what that means. It's a show of blessing from the home. This Pharisee, who should have done that, didn't even do that. But nevertheless, this woman has been performing, she's been anointing my feet again. And her sins have been forgiven as her great love has shown. Whoever has been forgiven little, loves little. You know, it's worth mentioning that this is the only time in the New Testament that Jesus described someone as loving him besides his father. I mean, do you get this? This is the only place in Scripture where Jesus says someone has been showing him love. That's pretty amazing. So this woman and then this churchgoer that Paul just talked about in Corinthians, who falls down in worship and proclaims that God is among us, it reminds us that worship can only happen when we are so humble enough and so in awe of God's majesty that our only response is to fall before him with an attitude of reverence and wonder. You know, in fact, just as we read in Luke, Jesus takes this worship, this act of praise, even further by bringing love into the picture. So if the Old Testament act of worship is in awe and wonder, the New Testament act of prostrating takes it further with love and adoration. So not only should we reflexively bow in the awesome presence of our King, but we choose to do so out of adoration and gratitude and devotion and love for him. So it's amazing. You don't see this act of this bodily posture of praise too often in many churches. Sometimes you do in overwhelming worship situations and some larger churches maybe, but it's not regularly practiced. And I'm asking myself this too, like, I wonder why we don't see it too often. In Philippians 2, verses 9 through 7, we read, therefore God exalted him, Jesus, to the highest place, gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of the Father. Did you get that? Every knee should bow in heaven. My clicker is not working, so I'm not going to let it distract me. Every knee should bow in heaven, on earth, and under the earth even. Did you know that hell reflexively responds and bows to Jesus at his name? I mean, do you believe that? Listen to Mark 5, verses 2 through 7. When Jesus got out of the boat, this is a powerful scene. A man with an impure spirit came from the tombs to meet him. This man lived in the tombs. No one could bind him anymore, not even with a chain. For he had often been chained hand and foot, but he tore his chains apart, broke the irons on his feet. No one was strong enough to subdue him. And night and day among the tombs and in the hills, he would cry out and cut himself with the stones. And when Jesus saw him from a distance, this man ran and fell on his knees in front of Jesus. And he shouted at the top of his voice, "What do you want with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? In God's name, don't torture me." And that's not the man saying that. That's Legion, the demons saying that. Here's the humbling question we need to ask ourselves. If demons prostrate themselves in awe and wonder before Jesus, why don't we see it more in our worship services? So the next word in Greek is proskomai and shavach. These words mean to pray to God, to speak to God, to offer praise to God. And in the Hebrew word shavach, it actually means to address in a loud voice, a loud tone, to shout, to commend, to glory, to triumph. And we looked at this in our series on Hebrews 5, verses 7 to 8. During the days of Jesus' life on earth, he offered up prayers and petitions with loud cries and tears. I mean, could you imagine witnessing his prayer in the garden? "Father, if there's any other way, could this cup pass me by? But nevertheless, thy will be done." I mean, to the point that he's sweating tears. He offered prayers and petitions to God with loud cries and tears to the one who could save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience from what he suffered. Jesus offered up prayers and petitions with loud cries and tears, and he was heard because of his reverent submission. This is what God wants from us. This is that come as you are. This is that moment when, "Father, I've lost a loved one. My son has been diagnosed with cancer, 12 years old. The tumor is the size of a golf ball. The doctors don't know if they can get it out. Father, why?" Sometimes in those moments, isn't it hard to say, "But nevertheless, thy will. Thy will be done." Those are tough prayers to pray. And that's why we need each other. That's why I need you. You need me to be there. To say maybe nothing, right? To just be there. And maybe say, "You know what? I wouldn't know what to pray either, but I'm here for you. And if you don't have the faith to believe, I'll believe for you. I'll believe for you." That's why we need each other, friends. That's why we need each other. When we talk and we pray to God, we're to do so out of humble adoration and submission. And God wants the tears. He's not afraid of them. He wants the anger, right? He wants our hearts. "Come as you are. Crawl up to my lap. Sob in my chest. I know life is hard, but come as you are. Come to me, my child." You see how all these words they begin to weave together into a richly woven tapestry of worship. It's complex. Humanity is complex. Emotions are complex. So worship is complex, because God wants it all. True, heartfelt worship is complex and rich and layered and deep. Listen to Psalm 63. David composed this psalm in the wilderness, relentlessly pursued, yet still able to cry out in humble adoration of God. Psalm 63, verses 1 through 5. "You, God, are my God. Earnestly I seek you. I thirst for you. My whole being longs for you. In a dry and parched land where there is no water, I've seen you in the sanctuary and beheld your power and glory. Because your love is better than my life, my lips will glorify you. I will praise you as long as I live. And in your name I will lift up my hands. I will be fully satisfied As with the richest of foods, with singing on my lips, my mouth will praise you. Could you praise God like that in the desert? Could I? Thirsty for water, hungry for food, how many days? The author of the book, this is a great book, and I think Leanna took you through this book, Holy Roar. This is a wonderful book. This focuses on the Hebrew words. And the author says this. He says, the most vivid cultural shabach, remember that word, it means to declare in a loud voice, to proclaim, the most vivid cultural shabach that I have ever seen happened recently, the author writes. It was a gathering more than 5 million people. Can you imagine? It was reported as the seventh largest gathering in human history. At one point, the crowd gave a full-bodied, full-volume shout at the top of their lungs. It was a thunderous sonic boom. It was a unified, colossal roar. The location, Hutchinson Field in Grant Park in downtown Chicago. The occasion, the Chicago Cubs, after 108 years, finally won the World Series in 2016. And the author says, as a former resident of Chicago, I can appreciate how Cubs fans, us Red Sox fans know a little bit of the, you know, the curse that lasted so long, but that 108 years without a World Series victory, entire generations of Chicagoans have been born, grown up next to Wrigley Field, lived long lives, died without ever seeing the Cubs win it all. This was a shout that represented a century of pent-up anticipation and disappointment. A corporate celebration. It's the clearest image of a shabach, a cultural, generational, communal shabach. Every time we gather as God's people to praise Him, one voice unites with another. Right? Online, in person. Anthems become declarations. Declarations become a holy roar. The notion of Shabbat transcends geography, right? It's a holy roar that reaches from one generation to the next. In Psalm 145, the psalmist wrote, one generation shall praise, one generation shall Shabbat your works to another and shall declare your mighty acts. The holy roar of praise is not self-contained. You can't keep it in. Not just for a particular people or a particular place. It's not praise for the purpose of pumping up just us, right? It's for the purpose of passing on faith from one generation to the next. And friends, this generation, they need a holy roar to, what? With their phone. Did you say something? Ah! Praise God, right? The next generation, the future of the church, really they're hungry for a holy roar. The shout of praise needs your voice too, my voice. So listen to Ephesians 6:18, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert. Always keep on praying for all of the Lord's people. Pray without ceasing. Fall down and worship. Talk to God. Always proclaim His truth back to Him. Declare His victory to others. Triumph in humility, in reverence, in wonder. And both of the words we're looking at in the Greek are compound words. This is amazing. Pros eukamai, pros kaneo. That preposition, pros, is actually a smaller form of a word that means face. And really, prosopon is where it comes from. Face towards, face to face. John uses this in John 1. When time began, the Word was there. The Word was pros with God, face to face. The Word was God. This Word, when time began, was pros with God, face to face. All things came into being through Him, and without Him there came to be not one thing that has come to be. What a powerful image. This little preposition at the beginning of these verbs, and yet the truth is undeniable. For it's only when we fall before Him, friends, we fall before Him in love and devotion, our faces in the dust from which He created us, only then does He meet us in the dust, face to face. Praise God. Hallelujah. Yes? Just one more thing. Let's go back to proskuneo just for a moment, that first Greek word we looked at. This word has been debated. It's still debated today, but in looking at the etymology and the formation of proskuneo, many scholars believe that there's another meaning. It means to kiss towards, adoringly, literally to kiss towards. It's this Greek word that stemmed, it seems, from an ancient Persian word. In that culture in ancient Persia, whatever rank in society, they'd greet each other with a kiss out of devotion and respect. You know, those of equal rank would kiss each other on the lips. Those of lesser ranks, but still prosperous in society, would kiss each other on both cheeks. You can kind of see it in the culture today as well. The commoners, one greeting ones of higher rank, would immediately fall to the ground like this woman did and kiss the feet of the superior. Now listen to this, Romans 16:16, greet one another with a holy kiss. All the churches of Christ send greetings. 1 Corinthians 16, all the brothers and sisters here send you greetings. Greet one another with a holy kiss. 2 Corinthians 13, greet one another with a holy kiss. Now listen, some of us are probably puckering up. Don't worry. Don't worry. Let's contextualize this, okay? Here's what John Piper says. Kissing is not a uniquely Christian affection. What the apostles say is take your way of greeting each other, wherever you find yourself culturally, take whatever means is a comfortable greeting with each other and bless it, sanctify it, make it holy, devote it to God, make it say something about the Holy One. Include God in your hearts and in your thoughts when you greet each other with this ordinarily, culturally common greeting. Right? So when you greet each other, it should be a holy connection of intimacy. Welcome, brother. Welcome, sister. What a blessing to see you. We are both blessed by God, aren't we? And then greet each other with that holy kiss. What's the lesson? Whatever means of greetings we use, let them be genuine. I think what the apostles want to do is encourage us to use various culturally appropriate symbols of greetings with each other. Sanctify them, make them holy. What do we do today? We ball up our fists and fist bump each other, right? Well, greet each other with a holy fist bump, a holy handshake, a holy hand on the shoulder. That's what Scripture is telling us to do. It's a demonstration of camaraderie, of family and affection. We're all brothers and sisters in Christ. Hallelujah. It's so good to see you. The point is, Christians should feel genuine affection for each other. Do we value God enough to give Him the reverence and honor He deserves? Is our worship a stale ritual? And I'm not saying it is. But we should always be mindful of how we can strive more to ascribe worth, the worth that is due to God, right? We can always do more. We can always strive to be better instead of a box we check on Sundays. Is it a reflexive reaction to His holiness? Are we willing to humbly bow before a mind, body, spirit, soul, to kiss our Maker, to meet Him in that humility, because He stooped down for us, friends. For only when we bow all that we are before all that He is do we truly encounter Him face to face. Yes? N.T. Wright says, we're celebrating the Lordship of Jesus Christ. That simply can't be a private hobby. Worship isn't something we do inside these walls and then go out into the real world and live our real lives. No, our worship is the real world. Amen? Whole life holy for a holy God. Our worship needs to resound outside these walls so that others can witness the reality of God the Father, Christ the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And then they're drawn in, and then they're invited to come in and participate in our worship of the King. That's reality. That's the real world. Amen? Amen? Say it again as a corporate Shabbat. Is that all you can do in your holy roar? Let's roar together, right? Amen. Hallelujah. God bless you. All right, I'd like to invite the team back up. You know, coming to this table, the heart of what we do on Sundays, meeting the Lord face to face at the table He prepared. We may not be shouting a holy roar, but when we meet Him face to face, there's a holy resounding, an impact in this world and especially in the spiritual, of fellowshipping with our Lord and Maker in triumph, right? In humility and grace. Come to this table in victory, in humility, but in praise. Amen?
Let's sing this together.
I come to the garden alone while the dew is still on the roses and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses and He walks with me and He talks with me and He tells me I am His own, and the joy we share as we tarry there none other has ever known. He speaks and the sound of His voice is so sweet. The birds hush their singing, and the melody that He gave to me within my heart is ringing. And He walks with me, and He talks with me, and He tells me I am. The joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. I stayed in the garden with Him, though the night around me is falling, and the blitz me go. Through the voice of woe, His voice to me is calling. And He walks with me, and He talks with me, and He tells me I am His own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known.
Just want to share a scripture this morning before we take part. Comes from the book of James, known as the book of wisdom in the New Testament. And you'd think, well, if it's wise, why does it say this? Consider it pure joy. No, I'm not getting that wrong. That's exactly what it says, pure joy. When you encounter many trials, because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance. Perseverance must finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking in anything. Now, if you're anything like me, when I was young, I had all kinds of visions of how wonderful my life was going to be. Everything was going to work out perfectly, and I was going to be a wealthy man, and I was going to be a popular person, and I was going to be able to enjoy anything I wanted to, you know, all the things we as children might think. But then life interrupts, and as an 8-year-old boy, I lost my mother. Well, that's a very powerful thing, not hopefully what most people have to endure, but the fact of the matter is life throws us curveballs all the time. And we need Christ in our life so that we can face those things, learn to endure whatever trials we may have to face. And many of them may not be our fault, but there may be others that are our fault. Either way, Jesus went to the cross for us. And he endured many trials and yet remained joyful and loving. So I just ask that when we partake together of the bread, which reminds us of his body, which he willingly gave on behalf of us all, as he said, Father, not my will, but thine. And as we take part in the cup, that reminds us of that horrible thing where his blood was shed on the cross. But it was shed for our purpose, to cleanse us, to give us hope, to give us courage, to give us determination that we will carry on no matter what we may have to face in life. So let us pray. Father, help us to consider it all joy when we encounter whatever trials we must face. But help us to know that we do not bear those things alone because you are with us. But also help us to remind ourselves and those around us that we are here to bear each other's burdens. So in our moments of silence as we take part together, we ask that you would refresh and strengthen us for the days that lie ahead. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, it's almost time, folks. Time to roll up our sleeves as we leave this place and get ready for another week. But before we sing our final hymn, I'd ask Paula if she could come up for a moment. She needs to share an announcement.
As many of you know, October is Pastor Appreciation Month across, I think, North America, I guess. Last week, we sent out an email to collect gift cards for our pastor, and I'd just like to present them to him. I thank you, whoever donated to this, and we just want to bless you today, Tripp. So.
All right, well, let's stand together. Is that too low?
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now
chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon
Father, it's been wonderful to be here and to share and so many different things and to see folks that, and to pray with one another and to bless each other. And we ask now that your blessing would be upon us, that as we go into this week ahead, you would help us to be your servant in whatever way you believe we can be used. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Now, what song?
The first one.